Well, continuing with our theme as we look at the year ahead and what bodes well for investors, or will this be a repeat of 2010, or is trouble on the horizon? Joining us on the program is Tony Boeckh. He's editor of the Boeckh Investment Newsletter, and he's also author of The Great Inflation, How Investors Can Profit from the New World of Money, one of my top 10 books for 2010. Tony, you know, as I went through all the forecasts for the year, there seems to be a general feeling that, one, economic growth around the world is probably going to be better than most people anticipate. Number two, it's going to be probably another good year for equity prices. They'll move higher. And three, at least at this stage, bond prices are due to go up, but that may not necessarily be a bad thing at the beginning. Would you go along with those forecasts, or do you think there's something wrong with them?
Well, no, it's, I think they sound pretty good. And, of course, when there's a consensus out there, you have to worry about it because it's usually wrong. So, but I'm sort of in that camp. I have been for a while. And I think what's happened, that people got really bearish last summer and last spring when the European debt crisis blew up and the market went down. I think by July or August, the market was probably down for the year, and people were pretty bearish, and bearish on the economy, and then the data started to get a little bit better, and market turned up before and forecast a better economy towards year-end. So I think most people are sort of moving kind of with the market and with the economic data. I find there's no real conviction out there, but I mean, clearly the economy is doing better. Stock market had a really good run in the last 4 or 5 months of the year, and I think that sort of set the tone for this kind of bullish consensus that's out there. And so, you know, I think whenever there's a clear consensus, one has to challenge it. It doesn't necessarily mean it's wrong, or maybe it'll be wrong, but much later. We just don't know. But there are clouds on the horizon. I personally think that a lot of the big worries out there, and there's three in particular. One is the European debt situation, which is by no means resolved yet. There's that. There's a problem with China and its undervalued exchange rate and all the currency tensions. And third, the spiraling U.S. government debt ratios. And those are all still out there. They're kind of like clouds on the horizon, you know, that are threatening a thunderstorm somewhere out there, but not necessarily going to create an imminent problem.
When you talk about you're still bullish, you mentioned that a non-inflationary expansion of liquidity. And right now, the inflation levels are low. Unemployment is high. During these periods, it's generally positive for asset prices. It's only when all of a sudden we get rising inflation expectations and rising inflation rates that it can become harmful. And just like I've heard it said that in the early stages when interest rates start to rise, it's not necessarily a bad thing for stocks because it's an indication that economic conditions are improving. It's only when it gets to a certain level combined with higher inflation rates that it becomes a problem. Would you go along with that too?
Yeah, I think that's exactly the right way to look at it. And I think we've been in a situation where interest rates were been really way below normal, in good part because of Federal Reserve policy holding short rates near zero. And then last year there was a real scare, you know, after the European debt situation and the weak economy, and there was a lot of people afraid of another downturn in the economy, the double dip thesis. And so I think there was a lot of speculation in the bond market. Bond prices got pushed way too high. So I think the first stage is with interest rates moving up, and, you know, that's, we're talking about the bond market now, because the Fed is really holding short rates down low. I don't think it causes a lot of problems for the stock market because, first of all, rates were too low. They're just normalizing. And then secondly, you know, if rising interest rates are reflecting rising business and rising profits, then, you know, the stock market has got a big positive going for it, which more than offsets the negative from the rising rates. So it's only later in the cycle when interest rates start to go kind of above normal and they start to bite and you get a pressure on the credit markets, credit conditions get tighter, that's when it's really negative for the stock market. And I think that's a long way off.
Let's also talk about this central bank liquidity that you write about in your newsletter, because when commercial bank reserves rise at a time of weak demand for loans from, let's say, bank customers, banks generally will go out and buy securities in order to earn more profit. And you have a couple graphs, but you talk about when this ratio is rising strongly, which has been the case recently over the last 2 years, this is a very positive sign for the stock market. And I think this is something a lot of the bears missed last year by staying out of the market.
Yeah, that's right. That's been the basic situation. The Federal Reserve has been pursuing an aggressively expansionary policy, and they weren't getting any traction because there was no demand for loans. So the banks were piling up excess reserves, and then when they do that, they've got to earn some money on them, so they invest in bonds. And that's always a sign of improving liquidity in the financial system and improving bank liquidity. And, you know, if you look over past cycles for the last 50 or 100 years, it's always been a very bullish sign for the stock market. There's nothing really in the horizon to change that. You know, the demand for bank loans is still pretty weak. And, you know, the Federal Reserve is going to keep policy, I think, pretty easy. I think that will change later in the year, but policy is going to stay pretty easy. And we have no inflation in the system. So, you know, liquidity is very plentiful, and the money has to go somewhere. And it's going into stock prices and some other assets, too.
All right. Let's talk about some of those clouds that you talk about. And I want to begin with the Eurozone debt crisis. So far, there's been a lot of the pig countries have had to tap the bond markets this week. You've had the Japanese participating. So it wasn't as bad as most people were thinking that this could have been an Armageddon week. You talk about until the stress to the global financial markets gets resolved, there's going to be some major adjustments. And you talk about three kinds of adjustments. I wonder if you might address each one of them, from the euro price going down, restructuring debt, to perhaps what Germany may end up doing.
Yeah, well, on the European debt crisis, you know, there's no question there's a huge problem out there with these heavily indebted countries. But what I think seems to be, you know, happening recently in the last week or so, and there's been bits and pieces of information floating around for longer than that, but I think the Germans are coming around to realizing that if the euro comes apart, if it really unravels, it's going to be a disaster for Germany as well as all the other countries. Because, I mean, just suppose for a second that, you know, Ireland and Greece and Spain and Portugal, they all pull out of the euro. You know, Germany's going to be left. It'll be basically a Deutschmark again. And the Deutschmark will go through the roof because all the other currencies will devalue sharply against it. And that would be a disaster for Germany, which has got a very nice economic expansion going that's been led by their exports. So Merkel, the Chancellor of Germany, has said, I think it was in the papers today, she said, basically, we'll do what it takes. And that's really what you need to hear from political leaders. You know, that's what Paulson, who was Secretary of the Treasury, said in the real crisis months of late 2008, early 2009. He finally said, we will do what it takes. And then you know that there's the backstop is there, that they will do something. We'll turn things around at some point. So I think as a crisis threat, I think the risks are lessening. We're not out of the woods yet, but I think it's going to start diminishing in importance. Anyway, that's my take on it. And ultimately, I don't think that's inconsistent with some restructuring of debt of the indebted countries. You know, that would take some pressure off, and I think the bond prices have already dropped so much that the bond prices really reflect some restructuring anyway.
Let's go on to the second issue, and it's almost like the U.S. has gotten lucky because the dollar has remained stronger than most people anticipated, especially when the Fed announced quantitative easing, and perhaps that's because everybody's focusing on Europe. But one of the other issues that you talk about that's a risk out there, we're certainly seeing it in my own state of California, where we're running just huge, monstrous budget deficits, and that is public finance. And the folks at BCA have a graph of U.S. government debt as a percent of GDP, and it's gone parabolic since the credit crisis hit in 2008. So you believe that this problem is or can be resolved, that the real issue here is politics, and you have an interesting take on this. I wonder if you'd explain that.
Yeah, I mean, it's a complicated issue, but I think, you know, the U.S. government spiraling debt, you know, that's obviously a problem out there somewhere. But I think the key point is, as long as the U.S. government can finance itself, that's not going to be a problem for the near future. It's going to be a problem further out. And the key thing that we've always said is key to watching is the U.S. dollar. And basically, it's been pretty stable. It's been in a trading range for quite a while. And in part, that's because it's the best-looking horse in the glue factory, so to speak, that all the other currencies are so bad. And, you know, ultimately, the Chinese are going to revalue. That will happen, maybe in good part this year. And that will also help the U.S. as well. So I think the U.S. is in a pretty good position, and I think